Hashem, we started a new perek, perek Shmini Ha'arel. This perek continue with the law of the eating truma by the Kohanim's family, especially those who have the issue of eligibility, meaning the Kohanim, the wives, the servants. Ha'arel v'chol atmeim lo yochlu bi truma. Rashi said, Kohen shemetu echav mechamat mila, meaning, God forbid, a fellow that have several brothers, the Kohanim family, priesthood family, and who passed away because of the breed, which means you have here Kohen that is in a state of thank you, Tum'ah. For example, his brothers passed, so therefore there is a concept of Sakanat Nefashot, meaning it's a life-threatening situation that if they do the Brit Milah, it may create crisis. So Rashi said, Mechamat Milah. Tosfot in general agree with Rashi, but Tosfot said in very short, just the vignette of Tosfot, he said that either he is afraid of the pain, because Arel Asur Lechol Betruma, right? He cannot eat. Or basically, there is a question that not just Tosfot, many other Rishonim asked. One of the idea that they used to do, it's still doing it in some ways, before the breed, they do Sichat Shemen, which means they put some oil, they are anointing the body with oil. Mm-hmm. So the question is, can they do that before? Because the whole Tzivui of Brit Milah applies, or the idea of Areilut applies from that moment. The question is, what do you do early? But anyway, the whole idea of anus, someone who's in a circumstance he cannot do something. So it's metzuve velo yachol, his commandment he cannot do it, or lo metzuve. I'll give you a small example, day by day. The Torah said in Kriyat Shema, ve'asavta deganecha, meaning you need to go to work in order to make a living. Yep. So the question is, how do you reconcile this with the mitzvah of study Torah? So if you go by the Stipler, the father of the Rabbi Kanievsky, so he said, look, if someone dedicates himself to Torah as much as he can, and then it's a mitzvah to go and make a living. So he go and make a living, and he doesn't have, in that sense, the mitzvah. He fulfilling the mitzvah of study when he have the time. Mm-hmm. When it's now no time, so it's not that he is a sinner by going to war, God forbid. He goes to war, he fulfills the mitzvah. The same idea of asafta deganecha, you go and you have the labor to collect your livelihood. So the Tosfot ended here and he said, the big question is before the Shmona Yamim, before the 8 days, is that considering Arel? So you have the Ritva and the Rashba and the Tosfot Yeshanim. The whole idea of met mechamat milah, the fear is of death because of the Brit Milah. That's what happened to his brother. V'chol atmeim, all the other Kohanim that reach a state of impurity and they are still not purified, lo yochlu bitruma. So the basically the man is a Kohen. It's only in technical issue, which is hasarat ha'orla, to remove the orla. So basically he can go and do the tvilah, but neshem ve'avdehem yochlu betruma. They are basically kinyan kaspo, so they can eat the truma. They don't have the issue of orla, they don't have the issue of tuma. Ptzu adaka uchrut shafcha. So that's a category that even the Torah speaks about. One who have the issue of wounded or crash testicles. So they have the issue of nisuim of regular bad Israel. Hen ve'avdehem yochlu, because it's kinyan kaspo. Unshohem lo yochelu. So basically, if he ba alehem, so chilel alehem bebiato. And since it's asur lavo bekahal, so ve'im lo yida'a. Im lo yida'a, it's like the language of Adam yada et chava, which means the Tosfot Yom Tov said that it's the implication for cohabitation. So the idea is, mishena asa, remember that word, mishena asa, from that moment, מי שנעשה פצוע דקה או חוט שפחה, from that very moment, after becoming disabled, so meaning from that point that he have those issues, he have no relation, הרי יאכלו, because it's no cohabitation, so it's not psilut, so they can eat in truma. ואיזו פצוע דקה, now we'll go to the detail, what does that mean, wounded or crushed his testicle? כל שנפצו הביצים שלו ואפילו אחת מהם. So it means not necessarily both, it's enough to have one of them, one of his testicle. וחוט שפחה, what does that mean, the one who's considered they have the disability, כל שנחרט תגיד, which means that they have some part, ונשתייר מאתרה אפילו כחוט העשרה. So it means from the hirschbart, which means the outer part of the gid, klapei chutz, from the outside, left, kasher. But he cannot do, אסור לו למול את עצמו, he cannot do it. סתני אמר רבי אליעזר, אלעזר, מנה להרל שאין אוכל בתרומה, שנאמר תושב את הסכים בפסח, אבל מה תושב את הסכים בתרומה? So we learn the verbal analogy, גזירה של אמר תושב את הסכים אמור בפסח, הרל אסור בו, אב תושב את הסכים אמור בתרומה, הרל אסור בו. So that's obvious, the whole idea of גזירה שווה. רבי עקיבא אומר, אינו צריך, we don't need to learn from that verbal analogy, because הרי הוא אומר, we learn in תרומה יצל ויקרא 22, איש איש, לרבות את הערב. So you basically learn from that ריבוי, in addition to that word, that it looks מיותר, looks superfluous, because it's written twice, we learn that הרל הוא נת איד בתרומה. מר מר, רבי לזר אומר, נאמר תושב את השכיר בפסח, ונאמר תושב את השכיר בתרומה, this is the same idea of גזירה שווה, verbal analogy. מה תושב את השכיר אמור בפסח, הרי לסור בו, תושב את השכיר אמור תרומה, הרי לסור בו. So the Gemara said מופנה. So in general, we have three categories of גזירה שווה. One, if you need it for the text itself, שאינה מופנה. Then you have if the two words is look like superfluous, and then you have if it's miyutar, it's a disputation tanaim in Nida 22. So here we talk about mufne, meaning that the word toshav vet sachir, it looks like miyutar, looks like superfluous. So we derive from that the verbal analogy, the il of mufne, that if you tell me that it's not פנויות לדרשה, that it's not ready to use it for that דרשה, and איקה למיפרח, you can challenge that גזירה שווה, מה לפסח שכן חייבים עליו משום פיגול, פסח when it's come to חומרות, if it become disqualified and or ונותר left over, or ותמה, something that is rendered a ritual impurity, so it's asur b'achila, you cannot eat it. So korban pesach is basically chamur, because notar, what left over, is tameh. Arel, asur, and that's now include pesach, but in truma, maybe you said in this coming to truma, the arel will not eat, why? Because it's less stringent. So the Gemara said, lai afnuye mufneh. Gemara said, the Gzera Shava is certainly open, is free. Otherwise, you can have Pircha. Hey Mufne, how? Ide Truma, if you tell me that the one we talk about Truma, which is a Meyutar, and it's come to teach us this Drasha, Mitzrach Tzrichet. Why? Because if you think about the text, so you have in one place, this, the Torah said, Toshav Sakhir Bekohen Lo Yochal Kodesh. Which means that Toshav Sakhir of the Kohen is not eating. Who is this Toshav? For example, you have a Hebrew slave, Hebrew servant, Eved Ivri, and he passed the 6 years of slavery. And then you have the Retzia, they take the ear, they put it, the Parashat Mishpatim in Shmo. And now he is Eved. How long is Eved? Torah said Adolam. What is Adolam?
Until the Jubilee year?
Until Jubilee year. That's the Olamo. Till the Yovel. So therefore, Eved Ivri Nirza, Eved Ivri that have this retziah, so he cannot eat in the truma, right? Now we said etanya toshav ze kanui kinyat olam, which means he is basically nirtzah, so he is not eating in truma. Sachir ze kanui kinyan shanim, meaning you have the 6 years, so he's also not eating truma. So that's a famous Gemara in Kiddushin. You remember we studied it. We said about the Eved Ivri. What is the Eved Ivri? It's two circumstances. Either Mecharu Bet Din or Machar Et Atzmo. Meaning, for example, someone stole a large sum of money and he cannot pay that money. So they have no choice, but in order to pay back, he sells himself as a slave. And therefore, in one hand, the master needs to feed him, to give him a place to stay. By the same token, all the income and all the rights belongs to the one who hired him. And if it's a compensation, he needs to pay to the entities that he owes. So basically, if he is a slave of Kohen, so he cannot eat the truma. V'yamer toshav al yamer sachir v'animer kanu kinat olam eno ochel. So it means this Eved Ivri, that he is nirtzah up to the Jubilee, and in any way you're not considered kinyan kaspo of the Kohen, so therefore he cannot eat the truma. Kanu kinat shanim lo kol shekel. So how much so? Because it's considered like his body is kanui. So why the Torah needs the word sachir? Ilu ken hayiti omer toshav ze kanui kinat shanim, aval kanui kinat olam ochel. So therefore, the Torah used the word sachir, and we derive from that also toshav. Bas sachir velimad toshav, she'av al bish kanui kinat olam en ochel betruma. So it's on purpose it's written, toshav en sachir, regardless if it's 6 years or up to the Jubilee, it's considering Yisraelim, and it's not considering kinyan kaspo of the Kohen. So, which means when using this term of Toshav Esachir, it needs to be written legufan and not for Gzera Shava Mufna. So the Gemara concluded Ela de Pesach Mufne. You have to say that the Toshav Esachir of the Pesach passage it's out, it's free from that Gzera Shava verbal analogy. Hi Toshav Esachir Kedav Rachmana be Pesach. My new, the one that we said that they are prohibited to eat in the Pesach lamb, who are they? Inei matoshav etesachir mamash, which means that that's applied to every divri that nirtza, or regular every divri. Mishum da'av elei toshav etesachir patar lami Pesach, just because shemachar et atzmo, because he sold himself, that mean that you give him the ptirut, the exemption of giving the Pesach lamb. והקיימלן לגבי תרומה, זה לא אחיו. הוא לא נרגל של תרומה, לתושב וסחיר, part of the Kohen ownership, he is not eating תרומה. Page 70, אלמה לוקן אלי רבי, which means he is a total Israel, he's not קניין כספו of the Kohen. And you see that the master does not acquire him as a, in a way, money or monetary that he have the acquisition, and the body of that Hebrew servant, it's not kainui lerabo, it's not owned by his master, and you cannot compare him to Knanite slave, that it's part of the Kohen who eat from that truma. Achaname, so also here, when it's come to Korban Pesach, Rashi said, the guf ha'eved, the eved itself, he is acquired by his master, and it's considered Israel gamur, total Israel, and he is obligated to Pesach. So it mean, you mean to say, v'chi ta'aleh al da'atcha, Rashi basically asked, that eved ivri by the Kohen is exempt from mitzvah of Pesach, because the whole kinyan of Eved Ivri, it's up to six, that is 6 years. So, up to the Jubilee. 6 years, and now you have, in a way, extension to the Jubilee. So six years, you understand, we understand that he's not לא רשאי לאכול בתרומה. 6 years he cannot eat tuma. Why? Because it's not considering kinyan kaspo. In a sense, he's adam bifnei atzmo. It's an independent entity. So therefore, he is mechuyav b'mitzvat Pesach, כמו ישראל אחר. He's obligated in Pesach like every other fellow Jew. Ela lafnuye. You have to say that this idea of tosha v'sachir, it's written to be free and superfluous verse for the purpose of gzeira shava. והקאטי, so still the whole concept of גזירה שווה, מופנה מצד אחד הוא. It's only free from one side, which is the תושב ושכיר and פסח. But the second one, the one that's written in תשומה, it's not מופנה. ושם אינן לי לרבי אליעזר, we derive from what רבי אליעזר said on page 104, דאמר מופנה מצד אחד, he said, if it's free from one side, למדין ומשיבין, right? You derive גזירה שווה, and you respond that you can do a pircha of גזירה שווה. So how do you derive the whole idea that Arel is not in Tumah from גזירה שווה of Pesach? Because you can go backward and said, the Pesach, you are obligated of Pesach. Why? Because Pigul notar v'tame. So therefore, Arel is prohibited. Versus Tuma, you don't have this chumrot of Pigul Notar Vetameh. Kevan de legufei lo tzarich. Because the word Tosha v'sachir, we said in Pesach, you don't need it for itself, which means that you have two extra superfluous words, and not one. Shdei chad alamed, u'shdei chad am lamed. You take these two words, and you derive as follows. One, truma, that you can derive from Pesach, and the second one is to melamed, to Pesach. V'hava legzera shava, mufna mishnei tzdadin. So you have gzera shava that is free on two sides, and therefore you don't have a pircha. The truth is that the many rishonim, and you see here the Tosfot, here's a lot of issue there, because the whole concept of Zoi Shiva, Zoi Bia, you don't need Mili Midukdakot, you don't need a specific word, you just need the subject itself. So if you even you use one of the words, which is you use either Toshav or Sachir, that's written in Pesach, and the second one is written in Tumah, you have an issue how to derive it, because it's two different words. So the Tosfot try to tell us that when it's come to Gzera Shavah, it's not necessarily means that Gzera Shavah is total equivalent matching words. Gzera Shavah can be a concept that you derive the, you perceptualize the concept and you make a juxtaposition by the concept, even by using one word. So that's the argument he tried to say. Because it basically can have two words that not necessarily match in letters, but have the matching meaning. Anyway, so they said here that Tosfot have more, much more to say about it. You're welcome to read more in Tosfot here. So now we challenge the Rabbi Eliezer. He derived a comparison, a gzera shava, between Pesach to Tumah. So they said, if you go by this Gzera Shabbat, by this verbal analogy, that is free in both sides, Ma Pesach Onen Asur Bo? What is Onen? No, help me. What is Onen? Onen. What is Onen?
Mourner.
Excellent. What is Onen? Tell me a little more.
It's a mourner in the initial stages of mourning, when they're right after the person passed away.
And
before they're buried.
And what is connection to here? Okay, so the Torah said in the Devarim, in the yes.
Yeah, they well, they, okay.
Gilbert, please.
That he cannot eat the Tumah because
why?
He's a
good.
Because he's a mourner.
Oh, so the thing is, there
well,
is a period of
Tameh, right? I mean, it's,
yeah.
It's not exactly manner of Tameh, it's manner of Aninut. The Torah said in Deuteronomy 26 mm-hmm. clearly they said lo achalti be'oni mimenu, meaning when, let's say, Mr. Reuven, his father Yaakov passed away, he did not bury his father yet, or any of the seven immediate family, right? Father, mother, brother, sister, son, daughter, and wife. Any seven immediate family. The period between the passing to the time of burial, that period is called onen, aninut. He is basically, in a very general term, free from performing mitzvot. So, right, when it's come to the Ma'aser Sheni, the second tithe, the Torah have the declaration, part of the declaration that they made when the Torah used in the book, in Book of Deuteronomy, Parashat Ki Tavo, they said, Lo achalti be'oni mimenu. I declare, hereby declare, when I bringing this fruit to Beit HaMikdash, that when I was in a state of aninut, which means when I was in the early stage of mourning, which is between the passing to burial, I did not eat it. The same applied to eating kodashim, sanctified food. So sanctified food, you meant to say, for example, one of them is the Paschal lamb, Korban Pesach. So you derive, that's Gemara in Zvachim we study, if you remember, Zvachim 101. You derive a Kal Vachomer Maaser Sheni, that basically the same you treated. If you treated the second tithe in that way, you treated, how much so, you treated also the sanctified Kodashim. So, if you remember, we studied in Zvachim, it's between 99 to 101 pages. It's three pages that are dealing with all Hilchot Aninut when it's come to Kodashim. So anyway, they said here, Im ma Pesach onen asur bo, when it's come to Paschal lamb, what we said, that the onen is prohibited to practice in it. Av truma onen asur ba. So you see the same applied to sanctified truma, that onen is prohibited to partake it. So why we don't say that this is prohibited because of this Gzera Shava? Amar Rabbi Yossi Bar Chanina, Rabbi Yossi Bar Chanina respond, and he said, Amar Kra, if you zoom in the text in Leviticus 22, verse 13, V'chol Zar lo yochal bo. He said, any outsider, any alien, any someone who's not part of that entity of the Kohanim, may not eat the truma. So it looks like superfluous, because we said earlier, in three psukim earlier, in pasuk, in verse 10, that is prohibited. So he said, Zarut amarti lecha velo aninut. I'll talk to you about alien, someone who's not being an outsider, but I'm not talking about aninut. So it means kohen onen, so far, can eat the truma. Eima, so the Gemara challenged that, and said, "Velo arelut." Maybe Kohen Arel, he maybe can eat. So he said, "Haktiv toshav estesachir lo yochal bo." So you see here clearly, meforash, that he's not eating. You have two psukim. One have ribui, and one has mi'ut. So the Gemara asks, Humara ita, how you learn this gzera shava of tosha v'sachir, that arel is prohibited for tuma? And now I'd go the opposite way. Maybe you should say the opposite, that the gzera shava is basically to prohibit onen from eating tuma. And the whole idea of this verse, we said v'chol zar, for someone who's outside, it's basically permit someone who doesn't have the brit milah. So they said mistabra areilut havale l'ribui. You're thinking in some that makes sense, logic, that someone who doesn't have the brit, you can derive in that prohibition, because it carry more chumra, more stringency from someone who has psilut in aninut. So now Rashi give us here the explanation of abbreviation. If you look at the abbreviation, it said it's here, ma'asim krutim bedavar ha'aved. So Rashi explained to us that it's just the acronym. Ma'asim, it's to the two chumrot. Krutim is anush karet. Bedavar, it's before dibur. Aved, it's a brit of zacharim ve'avadim me'akevet. Anyway, mechusar ma'aser ma'aser begufo v'anush karet v'yishno lifnei dibur, which means yishno lifnei dibur, it's before the Hashem said to Avraham Avinu to do it, before giving the dibur, the divine providence, the time of revelation of giving the Torah. Umilat zcharav, zcharav v'avadav me'akavet, which means someone who has a son, that he have the obligation to do the brit milah, or because that's basically incumbent upon the father, right? Before the baby cannot do the brit milah for himself, or the Canaanite slave. So since the owner or the father are basically obligated to do the brit, so they cannot eat a paschal lamb as long as they don't do the brit. So for example, if the father need to do the brit milah for his son, so as long as he's not do that, or for his Canaanite slave, he cannot go ahead and eat korban pesach at the time being. Versus in aninut, all of that you don't apply. So therefore, you derive this gzera shava that prohibited to eat tuma, told the concept of arelut that it's much stringent. And the whole idea of the whole zar, that someone who's outsider, that allowed to eat chuma, you derive from that to aninut adraba. You must go backward and said adraba, you should go the other way around, the contrary. And he said, sheken yishna bechol sha'a. If any one of the seven immediate family passed away, that person become onen. Versus arelut, if one time he has a brit milah, is something that is not returned. Venoeged ba'anashim v'nashim, applies to everyone. Versus arelut, that it's only for male. Ve'en biyado letaken et atzmo, which means it's not lo talui bo, it's not depend on him. So you have to hear the three tzadim, and you have the five tzadim, three avenues and five avenues. So you see arelo yichol b'truma. That's the five. That's the five tzadim. Nonen yuchal. So they said hanach nefishan. Gemara said these stringencies of being someone who's not have the brit milah. He said it's more than those of the aninut. So it's logical to expand the gzera shava as prohibiting someone who doesn't have the brit milah, rather than tonen, from eating tumah, yes.
I have a hypothetical question, Rabbi. Yeah. If a person son need to be circumcised, it's not the 8th day to circumcise him, and Pesach fall on that time, is the father allowed to have partake in the
brit? Can do brit on Yom Kippur.
Okay.
Brit on Yom Kippur, Shabbos, anything.
Okay.
Having a little bit of problem applying the logic of Rabbi Yossi Ben Kamina.
Okay, so let's see it.
So he says that because foreigners, non-Kohanim, are already prohibited from eating truma, so therefore the verse doesn't speak about aninut, but logically, doesn't the verse refer to an onen who happens to be a Kohen? Not a foreigner. I mean, it's specific. Because, I mean, obviously, a foreigner is already...
That's what the Rashba said earlier. That's what we said earlier, that you have here, basically, generally speaking, two entities. But it can be a combination of both.
Well, but I understand. But Rabbi Yossi Ben Chanina is saying that because foreigners are already excluded, therefore the verse is not referring to onen. Right?
For the
Gezeira Shava, right?
Correct.
Okay, but I don't understand how. I mean, foreigners and a Kohen who happens to be an Onen are two completely separate. I mean, they're not related at all. They're separate.
No. For the discussion stage, mm-hmm. not the final halachot.
Well, I understand. Yes, yeah, this is a discussion. I'm just trying to understand the logic.
To make a logical comparison by saying that someone who doesn't have the brit, who is in a state of arilut, it should be part of that prohibition because it's lacking of positive act, which means that you differentiate between someone that it's potentially can have the brit, someone that is male, someone versus the others.
But he's talking about nonen here. He says aninut is not covered. That's why I mean, just from reading this, and maybe I misunderstand what he's saying.
So far, we're in a stage that he said hanach nefishan, which we talk about two different ones. We have the five chumrot, and we have the three chumrot.
Right.
So he said that the five chumrot, the five tzedim, the 5 points, are more than the other three. And if you put it together, the whole idea of a orla, it turned to be more stringent than aninut. So okay. Therefore you derive the pasuk that prohibited this arelut. But we're not done yet. You have Rava.
No,
Rava.
I guess I understand. I understand we're not done. I guess this is more within the logical discussion, as I'm trying to understand how Rabbi Yossi Bar Chanina can say that aninut is not covered from there, because I my response to him based on what he was saying is yes, it refers to aninut of a kohen, not of an outsider. But anyway, I mean, that would be my. But you know,
the whole idea
I'm
of
misunderstanding
Arel,
something. So
Arel,
and
Arel,
I mean, I understand
betruma,
the Arel. I understand, and I understand
that's
what
five.
That's, yeah,
and here's the three.
Right, but anyway, that's.
All right, I need to look in.
Yeah, I mean, we're...
Okay, Rava Amar, Rava said, Belo hanach nefishan. So, even you take all these stringencies out, which means that he's not, doesn't have the brit, there are more than those of aninut. Name lo matze amar, so therefore Arel can eat betruma. Shavkinan arelu dichtiv begufe bepesach. You mean to say that because we take the arelut, that it's written in the Pesach passage itself, v'alfinan, and we derive from that aninut mi Pesach, we derive tumam Pesach to prohibited aninut, the Pesach gufei, because Pesach itself mi ma'aser gamrinan, we derive kal v'chomer from ma'asrot, that basically that form is prohibited to onen. So it's clear that you can derive this gzerah sheva of arelud that's written within the body of the text, and not derive the aninut that was not there. So if you derive this gzerah sheva and it's invalid, and you compare Pesach Truma, so you say that if you have the children or servant that they are not have the breed, so that's basically delay him, so they cause him not to prevent him from partake of Pesach lamb. The same applied to Truma. But the reality is not so, because the brit milah of his children or his servant is not prevent a person from eating truma. So why you derive this gzerah shava of ikuva makra? The Torah said, we respond in the Shmot in Exodus 12, umalta oto, and you should do the brit milah as yochalbo, and then after you do that with the Knanite servant, then as Yochalbo, the master can eat it. מילה שכרה ועבדה מעכבת בו מלאכול בפסח, מילה שכרה ועבדה מעכבת בתרומה. So you see here that you cannot compare it, it applies to פסח and not תרומה. יחי אימה, וכל הרי לא יאכל בו, בו אינו אוכל, אבל אוכל הוא בתרומה. Which means is derived from here that הרי eat in תרומה. So say, הכתיב תושב ושכיר, ומה ראית? Again, the same argument. מסתב הרלות בגופי אבל אלה רבוי, שכן מעשה בגופו ואנוש קרב. Because otherwise, if you don't do the ברית מילה, it's part of the קרב. So it means, what we derive from that? We said that the act of ברית מילה perform on his own body, and he have this punishable of karet, meaning someone who doesn't have the brit milah of his children or slave doesn't have those stringencies. The Gemara said adraba, on the other hand, milat zchara v'agavadav avale l'rabui. It's logical that those who doesn't have the brit milah for one's male children and slave should be included in this prohibition, shekan ishna bekol sha, because that's apply every single moment. The moment the person have a child, or he acquire a eved arel, so he is obligated. Versus when it's come to his own body, it's only one time. When he do the brit, it's not again. So he said again the same idea, hanach nefishan. So the whole idea of those stringencies apply to himself, but there are more than the stringency of the other. So it means it's very logical to go ahead and to use this gzera shava that prohibited someone who's not have the brit milah versus one that involved with his slaves or children for meeting tuma vibay tema. Another option, belo anach nefishan namelo matzi amarat ni ikamid idarelut gufei lo meakva bei arelut acharinei meakva bei. So himself is not leikuva so others. It's not. So you see here that the Gzera Shava, it applies to that case of one who personally doesn't have the brit milah. So the Gemara said, Hashta damre bo lidrasha udeata. Now you use the word umalta oto az yochal bo, come to teach us the truma. So therefore, what is said in Shmot 12, kol ben mechar lo yochal bo lamali. So what is the word bo come to teach us? The Gemara said bo, when it's come to the Pesach 21, hamarad dat posel velamarad dat posel maser. So if he's acting apostasy, that's make him ben echar, he cannot eat it. Versus when it's come to maser, second maser, the one who's mumar, he can eat. וכל הרי לא אוכל בו למלי, בו אין האוכל, אבל אוכל הוא במצא ומרור. So, ויצריך למכתב הרל, ויצריך למכתב כל בן החרדי, כתב רחמנה הרל, משום דמאיס, so therefore he's not eating. אבל בן החרדי לא מלך, he's משתמד, but it's not מאיס, he doesn't have the מאיסות בגופו, אמא לא. וכתב רחמנה כל בן החר, so he's משתמד, he cannot eat, משום דן ליבו לשמיים, אבל הרי ליבו לשמיים. Why? Because he, again, his brothers passed away because of the brit milah. Ema lo tzricha, so you need the two psukim. Now the Gemara asks God, mimenu, mimenu. Why you need to say twice, from it, from it? Al tochlu mimenu na, ולא תותירו ממנו עד בוקר. So, the Rav Bar Yitzchak. So that's something that we're going to study on page 77. אמר מר, רבי עקיבא אומר, לא צריך הרי, אומר, איש איש, לרבות את הערל, סווי מה לרבות את העונן, how do you just drive or el? אמר רבי יוסי בר חנינא, ואמר קרא בכל זר, זרות אמרתי לך, ולא ענינות. That's applied specifically to זרות, אימה ולא ערלות. הכתיב איש איש, which means we derive from that, that ערל prohibited to truma. ומה ראית? So the term nistabra, again, it's logical to say arelut havelei leribui. It's logical that being arel should be included in this prohibition. Sheken, ma'asim krutim b'davar ha'avel, as you remember that Rashi, mechusar ma'aseh, umchusar b'gufo, and ve'anush karel v'yishno lifnei dibur m'lad zchara v'akar v'akar. But that's the same logical argument. So the Gemara said, ad rabah, aninut havelei leribui, sheken yeshna b'kol sha'a. So you may say that the other way, that it's logical that aninut should be included in the prohibition against eating truma. Why? Because it's applied to every time. Ve'enoheged banashim ve'nashim versus arelut. Ve'en biyadol daken atzmo, he cannot do a remedy for himself. So it means that aninut is much more than arelut. So why you don't drive the pasuk? He said anach nefishan. That's the 5 verses 3. Which means arelut is much sooner than aninut. So Rava Amar, Belo anach nefishan, lama lo matzi amart. All this ish ish. Amar kra ish ish, zeh davar shishno beish beno beisha, ve'omer zeh arelut, not apply to her. Rabbi Akiva Amar, Toshav v'sachir ma yavid lei. So how you derive Toshav v'sachir from they may not eat in that Pesach, because it looks like superfluous. What we said earlier, that it's not speak about Hebrew servant, that is total Israel, and he eat in Pesach versus a foreign, we derive it from other psukim. Amar Rav Shmaya la'atui Aravi ma'ul ve'givoni ma'ul. Rav Shmaya said that this is to include a circumcised Arab and a circumcised givoni, which among those prohibition to eat the Pesach. The Meiri said, it's also in Tractate Sanhedrin, page 59, that even they fulfill the mitzvah of Brit Milah, it's the sons of Keturah, some said it's Hagar, the wife of Abraham. It's a big question if they're obligated or not obligated, but that's the way they do it. But still, when it's come to Pesach, it's a different story. They cannot partake. So, you could consider that mulim v'atnan, we learned in Mishnah Nedarim 31b, konam she'ani ne'ena la'arelim, mutar be'arele Yisrael v'asu be'mule obdei kochavim. Konam she'ena le'mulim mutar be'mule obdei kochavim v'asu be'arele Yisrael. So that's part of v'chol arele yochal bo, ela, la'atu eger she'mal ve'lo tavar, ve'katan shulal she'u ma'ul, ve'kasavar, צריך להטיב בו דם, ממנו דם, he hold that he needs to do at a fat breed. That's what we study in Shabbat 135. If someone was born circumcised, so you need to have at a fat dam breed, because we derive from the וגם את בדם בריתך שילחתיך הסירייך מבור אין מים בו, that's in Zechariah 9. So you derive from that, they have to have a tafal breed. Rabbi Eliezer Letamei, the Amar, what we study in page 46, Ger Shemal Velo Taval, Ger Me'al Yehu. Because Zavar Kanak Katan Shemambud, En Tzach Latif Menodam. Allowed to eat Korban Pesach. So they ask, how would Rabbi Eliezer derive? Rabbi Eliezer, Ish, Maya Vidlei, how we derive the concept of the word written twice, Ish, Amen. So they said again, Dibrat Torah Kilshon Ne'adam. The Torah used the language of people, common language, and therefore, that's the language that people use, ish. And you cannot derive an exposition from that. So it's like anthropomorphic, it's a human language that Torah used.
שולוים מלאכי, השולוים מלאכי.